Shalom and blessings, warriors of Yahuwah in the truth, children of Yahuwah in the truth. We are continuing on with the Action Besorah, Yahuwah's redemptive story. We are on unpopular prophecies based on Jeremiah and 2 Kings 23:36 through 24:1. The new young king, Jehoiakim, continues his ancestors' tradition of dishonoring Yahuwah. My father ordered us not to worship any Elohim but Jehovah. It says Jehovah. And look what happened. Yehuda is no longer a free country. Clearly Yahuwah cannot save us. It should be allowed to worship any Elohim anybody thinks might help us. Maybe the Babylonians' Elohims. To Jeremiah's dismay, the people had not really believed in Josiah's reforms. In their hearts, they are happy to follow Jehoiakim and his idol worship. So Jeremiah preaches at the entrance to Yahuwah's temple. You think Yahuwah is satisfied with you because you are circumcised, but you must also circumcise your hearts. The people don't listen, so Jeremiah comes back to prophesy at the temple again. Because your hearts are false, your worship does you no good. Your prayers do you no good. Your sacrifices do you no good. Again and again, Yahuwah has tried to discipline and correct you, but it does you no good. So now Yahuwah will destroy Jerusalem and exile you to Babylon, because you serve foreign Elohims or foreign mighty ones in your own land, and you will now serve foreigners in a foreign land. And again, if you really know everything, when is this supposed exile going to happen? You should start packing. No. The guy was prophesying, honey. At these words, the crowd flies into a rage. They drag Jeremiah to the city officials. He is speaking against us and against Elohim's city of Jerusalem. He should be stoned to death. What do you have to say for yourself? I am only saying what the Adonai himself told me to say. Your own behavior and actions have brought this punishment upon you. And if you kill me today, the Adonai will add it to your list of sins for shedding innocent blood. Thankfully, one of King Josiah's old officials is at the temple, Ahikam. He has been an honest and righteous man in the service of Josiah, and he believes in the ministry of the Adonai through Jeremiah. People, what Jeremiah says is not new. The prophet Micah predicted the same thing about Jerusalem about a century ago, and King Hezekiah did not put him to death. We must not kill this man for speaking similar words. The people are still infuriated with Jeremiah, but they cannot stone him without Ahikam's permission. Sulkily, they retreat. For now, as Jeremiah brushes himself off, a young scribe, Baruch, comes forward. The one I've been reading about in the Sefer. I believe you, Jeremiah. Is there anything I can do to help you? I need someone to write down my prophecies. These people may actually kill me someday. And Yahuwah's word must live on. That Jeremiah is such a doomsayer. I know he gets so angry about little things, but because I burn incense to the G-O-D-D-E-S of heaven doesn't mean I don't still worship Yahuwah. You can't worship two Elohims. Right now that the Babylonians are in charge, it never hurts to bake some bread in the name of Ishtar. No. And the people's sinning continues. That winter, Jeremiah asked Baruch to read a prophecy at the temple for him. You think because you have a covenant with Yahuwah that you are allowed to do evil things, but a contract with Yahuwah does not save you from the consequences of sin. I must get that scroll and read it to King Yehoiakim. I have a feeling he won't be pleased. Roscoe, enough. The evil king doesn't say a word as Jeremiah's prophecy is read to him. Instead, when his official is finished reading, Yehoiakim silently takes the scroll and throws it into the fire. After he watches it burn away to nothing, he finally speaks. Arrest Jeremiah and Baruch. Maybe prison will shut their mouths. But Jeremiah and Baruch have already hidden themselves. This is too hard, Jeremiah. Everyone is against us. Life is nothing but pain and sadness. It's going to get sadder and more painful yet for the people of Yerushalayim. But you should be content with what you have. The Adonai promises that he will at least spare your life. Soon Yahuwah gives Jeremiah and Baruch another message to share with the people, whether they want it or not. This will do nicely. I'd like to buy this pot, please. People, isn't this a fine pot? The potter clearly took his time and crafted a beautiful piece of art. Suddenly he smashes the pot to the ground. Smash! And even though Yahuwah set our people and our city apart and have turned your backs and you have turned your backs on him, so he will smash this city to pieces just like I smashed this pot. You have been warned. Roscoe, stop it. A priest named Pashur hears the commotion. He comes over and sees the shattered remains of the pot and the people murmuring among themselves. Hello, Jeremiah. What's the bad news from the Adonai today? You are. That's why Yahuwah is getting rid of you. At this insolence, Pashur has Jeremiah beaten and thrown into stocks for the night. In humiliation and pain, Jeremiah cries out to the Adonai. Curse the day I was born. Why didn't you leave me in the womb, Adonai? Why did you force me into being your prophet? Your words are nothing but doom and destruction, and the people hate me for it. But if I try to ignore your prophecies, your word burns in my heart and sets fire to my bones. But you are my protector. If the almighty Adonai cannot save me, no one can. I put all my hope in you. Jeremiah is released the next morning, but trouble brews in the palace. Why should we pay tribute to Babylon? I say let's stop and use the money to build up our own army. Then we'll be ready if Babylon attacks again. You're right. Those hostages in Babylon are not as important as all of us here in Yehuda. Word leaks out that King Yehoiakim is breaking his agreement with Babylon, but Jeremiah knows the king's decision is against the will of Yahuwah, and no one can defy Yahuwah. Ezekiel's exile. Based on Ezekiel and Jeremiah 29:1-14, King of Yehoiakim's revolt against Babylon is well underway. When suddenly he dies, Babylon easily overwhelms Yehuda's army. Young King Yehoiakim, who has ruled 3 months, is forced to surrender to King Nebuchadnezzar. This time I will take your treasures, your nobles, your skilled workers, and your king. Let this be a lesson to the ones who are left. So Jeremiah's prophecy comes true. The temple treasures are looted. The king and 10,000 of Yehuda's strongest men are led away. Prince Zedekiah is made king after he promises loyalty to Babylon. Frightened and weary from the 900-mile march, the 10,000 captives from Yehuda reached the gates of Babylon, the giant city of their conquerors. Ross, go! Ezekiel, a young priest, he's chewing on the couch. And his wife or Asha are among the captives, wondering where they will live. You Yashrelites can go to Tel Aviv on the Kabar River. There's unclaimed land there where you can farm and build your homes. I spent my whole life to be a priest in Jerusalem or Yerushalayim, but Yehuah is strong even when Yehuda is weak. He is Elohim, even this in this foreign land. In the months that follow, in the months that follow, Ezekiel works hard to make a living in the new land. It's not as bad as I thought it would be. We're together and they treat us well. But Yehuah has more in store for Ezekiel than being a farmer in a foreign land. One day, out by himself along the Kabar River, Ezekiel sees an awe-inspiring sight in the sky. That's like no storm I've ever seen. Fire bursts from the cloud. Four creatures, each with four wings and four different faces, flash back and forth like lightning. By each creature is a wheel within a wheel, and above all, this is a glorious throne. It's a vision of the glory of Elohim. And here is a glimpse of what the angels look like. Like I've been reading in the Sefer, they talk about how the angels have four faces. The only thing that's different is they don't have six wings. They only have four in these pictures. Okay. In a strange and beautiful vision, Yahuwah calls Ezekiel to be his prophet and speak to the people of Yerushalayim who are captives in Babylon. You are my watchman, Ezekiel. You must warn the people of danger. If you warn them and they don't listen, then I will still be proud of you. But if you don't warn them, I will blame you for their deaths. Following Yahuwah's command, Ezekiel builds a model of a city, and around it he puts an enemy camp. Then he touches a torch to his model, setting it on fire. No, not Yerushalayim, not our Kodesh city. It will be destroyed. To confirm Ezekiel's prophecy, Jeremiah writes a letter from Yerushalayim to the captives. Jeremiah says it is Yahuwah's will that we make our lives here because Yerushalayim really will be, stop you guys, really will be destroyed after 70 years. Bella, Yahuwah will let us go back. I've already made plans for you, Yahuwah says, plans that will give you hope and a bright future. The people are dismayed to hear about the destruction of Yerushalayim. I hope that Jeremiah promises sounds like small comfort compared to losing their homeland. Our beautiful city in ashes, why would Yahuwah allow it? Our forefathers worshipped idols. They're to blame for this. It isn't fair for this. It isn't fair that we have to pay for the sins of others. No, you too have sinned. It's your fault too, but Yahuwah loves you. He will forgive you if you stop doing wrong and start doing what he wants you to do. Those who obey Yahuwah will return home and build a new nation.
Please be good.
One day the spirit of the Adonai whisked Ezekiel far away to an ancient battlefield where many brave soldiers had died. In this forgotten valley, time and nature have left nothing but the bones of soldiers long dead. What do you think, Ezekiel? This is possible for these dusty old bones to come back to life? That's a trick question, Adonai. Only you know what miracles you can do. Prophesy to them, Ezekiel. Tell them that I will knit them back together again. Hold on, I'll show you guys the first page first. I apologize. And there's the angel. Okay, so he's going to knit these bones back together. Feeling a bit silly, Ezekiel obeys. Bones, hear the word of the Adonai. He will bring you to life. For a moment, all is still. Then the bones start to rattle and move. He will give you tendons and flesh and cover you with skin once again. And Yahuwah does this. As Ezekiel prophesies, the bones form back into human beings, but there is still no life in them. Tell them I will fill them with my breath, my spirit. Ezekiel continues to preach, and the bodies start breathing again. They come to life and stand up, thousands of them. Ezekiel is transported back to his fellow Yahudim in Babylon, where he tells them this story. And those bones represent Yasharal. If Yahuwah can bring dead bones back to life, he can bring the people of Yasharal back to Jerusalem someday. And when he does, he will fill us with his spirit. Yahuwah says, I will gather you from all the countries in the world and bring you back into your own land. It will cleanse you from all the filth and idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and keep my laws. You will live in the land I promised you. You will be my people and I will be your Elohim. There will be a new temple and a new Jerusalem. But Jerusalem will have a new name. That means the Adonai is there. The yoke on Jeremiah. Based on Jeremiah 27 and 37 through 38.
And this is Princess Bella Bean. She wanted to say hi to everyone. Yes, she did. She's not feeling too well today, so.
I just turned my volume up. I did not realize that my having an interview where even though they muted everybody's mics, it messed with my volume. So it was at 71, so I hope you guys can hear this video. I turned it up now, so now it's at full volume. A yoke on Jeremiah, based on Jeremiah 27 and 37 through 38. Based back in Jerusalem, King Zedekiah still rules on as long as he remains loyal to Nebuchadnezzar. For a few years, Zedekiah pays his tribute to Babylon. Then, in spite of Jeremiah's warnings, he begins to think about rebelling. He calls together the other foreign kings who are ruled by Babylon. We get peace. What do we get from the money we pay to Babylon? Peace, but not freedom. Maybe the Mitzrites or the Egyptians will join us. They hate Babylon too. When Jeremiah learns that there is talk of another revolt, he puts an ox yoke on his shoulders and bursts into the king's conference uninvited. What are you doing? Yahuwah has raised up Babylon for a purpose. Everything on earth, including the wild animals, will serve Babylon's king. If you try to throw off the yoke of Babylon, you will be crushed like leaves underfoot. Serve under the yoke of Babylon and you will live. Any prophet who tells you otherwise is lying. All right. But one of the prophets is in attendance, Hananiah, doesn't appreciate Jeremiah's interruption. Oh, really? Because Yahuwah told me exactly what to do with the yoke of Babylon. Break it. Crack. I predict that in 2 years, Babylon will be destroyed and we'll get all our temple treasures back. That's great news, if only it were true. Unfortunately, you will be proven wrong. You may break a wooden yoke, but the yoke of Babylon is made of iron. Yahuwah is tired of your lies in his name. You'll be dead within the year. Zedekiah knows Jeremiah is a true man of Yahuwah, but he doesn't want to listen. Even when Hananiah dies a few months later, Zedekiah still doesn't want to believe Jeremiah. During all of this time, Egypt or Mitzrayim has kept an anxious eye on the growing tensions in Yehuda At the right moment, it sends an ambassador to King Zedekiah. Babylon is your enemy as well as ours. Alone, neither of us could defeat them, but together we can do it. And that's where they have the peace talk to fight together against Babylon. As Jeremiah prophesied, Babylon answers their latest revolt with a swift attack. For weeks, the soldiers of Yehuda fight to defend Jerusalem's walls. Where are the Egyptians? They promised they would come. Suddenly, the attack stops. The Babylonians are breaking camp. They've given up the siege. We've won. Yehuda is free. What does Yehuda have to say now, huh? The people think they've won, but Yehuda has revealed the truth to Jeremiah. No, the Babylonians have not quit. They've gone to stop the Egyptians who were coming to help us. They'll be back. How does he know so much about what the Babylonians are doing? Because he's a prophet, dummies. That's what I'd say. A few days later, Jeremiah starts on a trip to his hometown a few miles from Jerusalem. Before he gets out of the gate, soldiers stop him. What? I've only spoken Yahuwah's truth. You're the one who prophesied that Babylon would conquer us. This is all your fault. Since you don't support us in the war, you're a traitor to Yehuda. In spite of his innocence, Jeremiah is thrown into prison. Within a few weeks, the Babylonians defeat the Egyptians and return to the gates of Jerusalem. Jeremiah's enemies bring him before the king and accuse him of being a traitor. I repeat the warning Yehuah gave me. Invaders from the north will conquer Yehuda. Yehuah chose the Babylonians to destroy our nation because of the sins of our people. It's this kind of talk that means our soldiers lose courage. Put this traitor to death or the city will fall. He's in your hands. Do what you want with him. Quickly before the king can change his mind, Jeremiah's accusers put him in an old empty well beneath the prison floor. Let him starve to death. These people were vicious. The old well doesn't have water in it anymore, but it does still have mud and slime. Jeremiah gags to be trapped in such filth and wonders how long he could survive. But Ebed-Melech, a servant in the palace, gets permission from the king to put Jeremiah in the prison yard. Thank Yahuwah for your help. I would have died in that awful hole. As the siege continues, people in Jerusalem are starving and beg for food. At last, the frightened king calls for Jeremiah. What will happen to us? It's simple. If you surrender, Jerusalem will be saved. If you don't, it will be burned, and the Babylonians will torture and kill you. Surrender? I don't dare. My own people would turn against me. You should be more concerned that Yahuwah has turned against you. Zedekiah is unhappy with this answer. He keeps Jeremiah under house arrest. The siege goes on, but after 30 more months... This goes along with it, but I don't want to make the video too long for you guys. Jerusalem falls. That is what happens when this is the fulfillment of the prophecy Jeremiah gave in the last chapter. I hope you guys all enjoyed the story today, and I hope it has brought you courage and love in Yahuwah and has brought you closer to wanting to read some of the Torah or the Besorah, the BYNV. I have been led in my Ruach to read the Sefer and to obtain the Sefer and the Seferim books because it is the end of time and we don't have much time left. And those books have a lot of prophecy and they tell about what the heavens are like. So I have to continue sharing them and I hope people understand. I love you all. Time to praise Yahuwah. Torah Rabba Abba Yahuwah. Torah Rabba Abba Yahuwah.
Yahuwah is with me. Yahuwah is for me. Yahuwah is greater than all of these things. If all of them is for me, then who can be against me? From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, Yahuwah's name will be praised. Yahuwah is with me. Yahuwah is for me. Yahuwah is greater than all of these things. If Elohim is for me, then who can be against me? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Shalom and blessings, beloved of Yahuwah and the truth, children of Yahuwah and the truth, and parents who are guiding and teaching them. Shalom and blessings.